Well, thanks to the American Legion Band. What a great performance. Thank you for being with us today, friends. Thank you for joining us on this Veterans Day. And for those of you who are joining online, we welcome you and are glad that you're able to be with us. I want to recognize and give appreciation to our active duty service men and women, to our veterans who are here today. Thank you for your service. And for those international service personnel and veterans who may be present, we welcome you also to this ceremony. We recognize and appreciate the presence of Congressman Emmanuel Cleaver and the Mayor of Kansas City, Quinton Lucas, the Board of Directors of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, including our Chair Elaine Cook. Thank you also for being with us. Also in our presence is Monique Seafried, who is a fellow commissioner with the World War I Centennial Commission. Monique, thank you for being with us. Monique spoke here a number of years ago, is French, and has given great service to the cause of the World War I memory through the years. I appreciate the Jackson County Executive's Office and the NTDF, and whether or not, for your support in underwriting free admission for our veterans and active duty personnel and providing half price admission to the general public. On this Veterans Day, we're also reminded of the importance of participating in democratic processes. Last month, I had the opportunity when in the UK to visit the Royal Armour Corps archives in Bovington, which is about 3 hours southwest of London. And at that place, I held in my hand my father's service record from World War II. He served from 1943 to 1947 in tanks and armored vehicles. In his own handwriting, he had written his name, and then under that was listed in others' handwriting the places where he served in war for almost 5 years. His service was for the cause of democracy. Those who we honor today, and I think of you in the audience, of the lives of those who you hold dear, like Fred, my dad, who served for the cause of freedom, liberty, and democracy. Our work this Veterans Day is to honor their service. And it reminds us that each of us have a part to play in preserving the values for which they fought. It is up to all of us to play our part. Shortly, we'll commence our opening exercises. I want to tell you what those will be. The POW MIA chair cover in remembrance of those whose service personnel were lost or captured will be placed by Colonel James Pangalinan and Command Sergeant Major Brian Billings. Munson Army Health Center at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas will present the colors. Sarah Hawkins, Donnelly Humphrey, and Zane Thomas, Junior ROTC, Lincoln Preparatory College Preparatory Academy in Kansas City, Missouri, will lead the Pledge of Allegiance, after which Wade Odell will sing the national anthem. Mr. Odell is a professional opera singer and is performing with the Lyric Opera of Kansas City this season, including the role of Alfredo in this weekend's La Traviata. Following the national anthem, the colors will retire, after which Congressman Emmanuel Cleaver will escort Colonel James Pangalinan and will place the wreath of remembrance. Following the opening exercises, Reverend Carla Aday, Country Club Community Church, Kansas City, Missouri, will offer the invocation. And a point of interest for you is that the grounds upon which the church stand on Ward Parkway were used as a training location for the 3rd Missouri Regiment preparing to enter the war in 1917. Following the war, victory gardens were planted on those grounds. And additionally, Reverend Ade's nephew is a Brigadier General in the United States Army and serves in the Indo-Pacific region. So friends, thank you once again for being with us today. Please stand, if you're able, for the placement of the POW chair cover and remain standing until the benediction is offered.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming.
Let us pray. Spirit of life, you are more ready to listen than we are to pray. You know that we long for peace at home and peace around this planet that you have created. We gather this morning to celebrate the end of war, to honor your children who nobly serve the common good by defending the values of their country. We gather to remember the victims of war. Thank you for creating within us the impulse to love, for granting us the courage to sacrifice for the sake of freedom, for binding us together in friendship and fellowship with our brothers and sisters in the whole human race. Bless all who gather here this day as together we seek to live lives that reflect your goodness, your integrity, your justice, and your compassion. Amen.
Please be seated. We are so fortunate at the Museum and Memorial to have hundreds and hundreds of volunteers. Those who greet you as you arrive, there are more than 300 of those volunteers, many of whom are veterans, last year giving 57,000 hours of service. We are so grateful for all that they do. And to our Board of Trustees, those community volunteers who ensure that we stay true to mission and are able to attest to our donors that the gifts made are used in accordance with their wishes. I'm grateful that our board chair, Elaine Cook, has served for 2 years, is the outgoing board chair, but still remains on the board. And I'm grateful that Elaine is with us this morning. So please join with me in welcoming Elaine Cook.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the National World War I Museum and Memorial for our 2022 observance of Veterans Day, a national day designated to honor those who have pledged to protect America's values and our democracy. This day allows us to show our gratitude for their sacrifice and service. So thank you all for joining us on this special day. We appreciate you helping us to honor our veterans and our active duty personnel. This is my last year as chair of the board of directors, and I'm gonna be passing the mantle on to Marty Nevshimal. I have felt like I understand those who serve and our who currently serve and who are veterans better because both of my own children and my son-in-law serve in the United States Army. But Marty will take us a step beyond that because he himself is a veteran. He served in the United States Marine Corps where he was a captain, and while on active duty, he was awarded the Marine Corps Intelligence Agency Intelligence Officer of the Year Award, so he will serve us well. So I've had a couple of easy years to serve as chair, you know. It's been a challenging time for all of us as we have adapted to the pandemic and the changes it brought to us. And I was so thrilled to witness firsthand the support and generosity of our supporters and donors throughout the pandemic. It was really amazing. And Matt Naylor and the staff kept the museum open every minute they could. It's really been just an honor to see this happen. I've watched our capable staff and supporters work tirelessly to serve our community here in the Kansas City region and across the globe. Our work remains as important as ever, and it's been an honor to play a part in supporting our mission. And I'm not gonna go away. I'm gonna still support the museum and memorial, just not as board chair. I invite you all to go visit the Museum and Memorial following today's ceremony in the Wiley Gallery. We have a newly installed exhibit called Captured, curated by our museum team, and it was actually written up a very laudatory praise in the Wall Street Journal article yesterday. This exhibition shines a light on the 9 million people who were prisoners of war in World War I. It's one of the most common experiences, but least talked about experiences of the war. So I think you'll find it very worthwhile and educational. The veterans of World War I are now all gone. we no longer have their firsthand or their living firsthand accounts of their experiences, although we still have their recordings and documents. Lest they forget is a phrase often attributed to World War I. I think the fact that there are no longer any living World War I veterans makes our museum and memorial all that much more important to continue to tell their story. The museum and memorial's work and purpose is to make sure they're not forgotten, and with your commitment and support, their stories continue to be told. Thank you for being here today. I hope you take time to enjoy the museum and memorial and everything that is here. It is, after all, your National World War I Museum and Memorial. Thank you all.
I'm very happy to introduce Qassam Rahimi. Mr. Rahimi is an Afghan journalist and current immigration specialist with the Jewish Vocational Services of Kansas City for some remarks.
Hello and good morning, everyone. Let me start by paying tribute to all those who are working to make the world a safer place. To the soldiers and security forces of the United States. Thank you to those who serve to provide security for democracy in communities around the world. This is not possible except with love for individuals and for the United States. Love for country and people is one of the many great themes of history. My name is Qassam Rahimi, a member of Hazara tribe who are facing in genocide and a citizen of Afghanistan. Right now, I am one of the 1,000 who do not belong to any country and one of the hundreds of refugees who has just moved in Kansas City. I am here now. I am belonging to new people, new community, new love by the name of United States. Thank you for who supporting me, especially from my colleague in Jewish Vocational Service. During the 20 years long presence of the United States forces, Afghanistan went through its most prosperous historical period. Democracy, human rights, freedom of speech, elections, and thousands of other human values were formed in this country that was previously a home to terrorist organizations. The young generations of Afghan people had hoped for a better future, to be connected to the world, and to no longer be considered a threat to the future of anyone. In these 20 years, nearly 3,000 American soldiers were killed in Afghanistan, and more than 20,000 others were wounded. I am grateful for all the sacrifices that the United States made for the people of Afghanistan. They sacrificed their life for the security of the United States, Afghanistan, and for democracy. The fight and terrorist threats still continue for the Afghanistan, especially for the people of Hazara. The Hazara people are fighting now against darkness and terrorism with pen, book, and knowledge. I welcome you to join me, Jewish Vocational Services, and World War I Museum and Memorial to learn more about how you can continue to aid and support them. The people of Afghanistan and the people around the world deserve a safe life. And the United States military has for over a century stood up and united with others to work to create a world safe for democracy. This is to be our contribution to history. Happy Veterans Day to all who have served for a secure life and secure world. Thank you. I love you all.
I'm very pleased to welcome now for some remarks the Mayor of Kansas City, Mayor Quinton Lucas.
Good morning. It is an honor to be back with you at this ceremony, at this event, as we recognize your service. And to make sure that we're all energetic enough this morning, I wanted to get a little bit of audience participation. I want to ask all of you who have served our country in the armed forces, please rise if you're able so that we may recognize you this morning. Thank you all very much, and thank you for your service. As you recognize, while your soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, Coast Guardsmen, your service did not stop with your engagement in the United States Armed Forces. You serve in our communities as mentors, as parents, and as friends, and you've touched the lives of many of us. When I was a young man, a little boy actually, I was living in Kansas City. My mother was raising three children by her lonesome. And at a certain point, she called my uncle, who was serving in the United States Air Force, and said, you know what, I think I need some help in life. Where's a good place to go? Where's a good place where there's no trouble? While he was at McConnell Air Force Base, he said, there is no place that's calmer and quieter and where you won't get in any trouble, no place better than Central Kansas. And so that moved me and the family for a little while to Hutchinson, Kansas, just a little bit outside of Wichita. And I promise, we found no trouble. And there maybe wasn't as much excitement sometimes either. But nonetheless, over those years, when he was stationed nearby, he was a mentor, he was a second father to my sisters and I. Then when he was deployed to Desert Storm, he continued to write to us, tell us about his life, tell us about his adventures, tell us about his dreams. And he was someone who always said that you need to make sure, Quentin, you grow up to be somebody who cares about service and takes care of his family. Those mentors aren't unique to my uncle, they aren't unique to the Air Force, but there's something that's ingrained in every branch of our armed services and in every one of our communities. We recognize Veterans Day not merely because of our history, but because of the impact you all have each and every day in America and in the world. I thank all of you for your service. I appreciate seeing some of you at this ceremony each and every year, and I have one other ask from all of you. That service tradition has continued in my family. My two oldest nephews, one serves in the United States Marine Corps, the other in the United States Army. The Marine serves in the Color Guard in Minnesota, actually, so he has appeared at many Minnesota Vikings games. I've asked him if he could appear before a better football team like the Chiefs, but we'll see what the Marines end up doing with him. My soldier nephew was recently deployed to South Korea. And in a rarity for a 22-year-old, I called him on Sunday, right before he left on Monday of this week, and he actually answered the phone. And I said, well, what are you thinking? What do you think about what's coming ahead? And he said, I signed up, and I'm ready. That's what so many of you did. I pray for him. I pray for everyone who's serving now, but more than anything, I pray for all of you, that you may continue to mentor those who are serving now, you may continue to be mentors to so many in our community, and that you will continue to be cornerstones and pillars of our democracy. Truly, God bless America, but also this morning, God bless all of you. Thank you so very much.
The Armed Forces Medley, also known as the Armed Forces Salute, is today recognized as a collection of the official marches or songs of the six service branches of the United States Armed Forces: Army, Marine Corps, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, and as of 2020, the Space Force. Today, the American Legion Band will perform the medley, but it won't include the Space Force hymn today because it was only released, the hymn was only announced a month ago, and it's not yet part of the repertoire. During the playing of this medley, we welcome those veterans and active duty personnel to stand when their appropriate branch song is played and to be recognized.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the wonderful music. And I want to once again thank all of you veterans who are here and who are watching us digitally. And you know, I sat down earlier and I thought, I need to quit calling my adult son and daughter who serve in the United States Army my children, so I'm going to seek to go forward from that. I am very excited right now, and we are very honored to have as our keynote speaker Lieutenant General Michelle Johnson, retired. Michelle Johnson is a retired Lieutenant General in the United States Air Force, where she served for 36 years. She was the 19th Superintendent of the United States Department of Defense Service Academy. Her previous positions included Deputy Chief of Staff, Operations and Intelligence, Supreme Headquarters, Allied Powers Europe, Air Force Aide to the President, Wing Commander, Deputy Director for Information and Cyber Policy at the Pentagon. I mean, she's had a busy life serving us. General Johnson is a distinguished graduate of the United States Air Force Academy in 1981, and she was in just the second class at the Air Force Academy that included women. As if that weren't enough, she completed graduate studies as a Rhodes Scholar before earning her pilot wings in 1984. Following her retirement from the Air Force in 2017, General Johnson was appointed Senior Vice President and Head of Referee Operations for the National Basketball Association, something she had done in her early years. Friends, please help me welcome General Michelle Johnson, who will bring us her address.
Good morning, thank you. Happy Veterans Day. I think we can say happy today because we celebrate people serving. We honor those we've lost, but it's a joyous day. Congressman, congratulations, and thank you for your time and your service. Mayor, as well. I was the commander of McConnell Air Force Base, not when your family was there, but it was also quiet then, so that's good. But I had twin sons while I was the wing commander there, so it wasn't quiet at my house, but it's an honor to serve in this region and the people who are here. I grew up in Iowa, if that's all right to say. And I want to thank not just the band for the music, but for the American Legion for the opportunity to go to Girls State and then the bicentennial year Girls Nation under the auspices of the American Legion Auxiliary and that leadership program. It really opened up the vistas of my life for the daughter of a move-to-town farmer who worked for the Farm Bureau, and I was born in Southwest Iowa, so almost in Missouri. So this really feels like coming home, and what an honor, what an amazing institution here to remember. I feel like I need to explain myself a little bit, but we would be here all day if I did all of it. So what I wanted to do today is just share from some experiences. When I was a two-star general in NATO, we lived in the southern part of Belgium, in Mons, Belgium. And I wanted to start today with some images from another person's perspective, another ally's perspective on this day, this Armistice Day, this Remembrance Day, and then bring it home to today in this modern profession of arms that serves in our nation's defense. So if you will. So one of the things about Americans is we like to assimilate and confuse things a little bit. Today, on the 11th month and the 11th day and the 11th hour, when the ceasefire started in 1918, Armistice Day, Remembrance Day started, and my colleagues at NATO took this very seriously, and with no disrespect to the paper poppies that we wear here, mostly on Memorial Day, but again, that just confuses things a little bit. Our colleagues, especially in the UK, Belgium, Netherlands, and France, wear poppies. Our French colleagues, as Monique can correct me, but wear cornflowers. So they have a blue flower that our French comrades wear. And even the Germans, because of the tremendous loss of life in World War I, they have a Memorial Day on the 13th. So on Sunday, they'll have a Memorial Day as well. And they really realize their role in those conflicts, but they also realize the humanity and the loss there too. So that's happening. I included a photo of Ypres, or Ypres, it sounds better when it's Ypres, but in Belgium you can either go French or Flemish, or Americans really stumble through either one. But this is town center on the 100th anniversary of the end of the war in Ypres, Belgium, the heart of Flanders Fields. And the reason I included this was what I wanted to talk about today was service and respect. That medieval building in the town center of Ypres was leveled in World War I, absolutely to the ground, nothing. And they rebuilt it, built brick by brick in the 20s and 30s with a refresh in the 90s, in the spirit of community. So often when people say thank you for their service, they don't really know what they're saying, they're being polite. But we in this room know it's about a sense of commitment to each other, a sense of the group more than the individual, which in a country that values individual rights is a balance, isn't it? It's a tension between loyalty to security and the group versus individual freedoms. And that's the tension that we have in democracies, and we cherish it, but it's a balance. It's a balancing act, and it's celebrated in Ypres because of the victory they had as a community to rebuild their town after the traumas of war. And serving in Belgium, really, it's on hallowed ground, not just from World War I, but throughout all the historic events that happened in Europe. In Mons, Belgium is only 30 miles from the battlefield at Waterloo, where Napoleon was defeated by Lord Wellington and Marshal Blücher in 1815. It's only 30 miles from Ypres. It's about, 50 miles to Verdun, France. And one of the most brutal battles in World War I took place at Verdun and around the Castle Domont. But when the Germans overran it, and by the time the French took it back, it was leveled as well. It's a very sobering place to visit. This is a picture of one of our vacation trips. Our boys were, twin boys were ages 8 to 10 while we lived there. So it was the Harry Potter years and Lego. But also we saw a lot of history as we went around. And so this is the Trench of the Bayonets. And the story goes that in 1916, when the battle was done and the French officers walked the field a battle to gather their dead, they found, the numbers vary, 12 or 21 rifles across this trench with a soldier's body beneath each one. And so the legend goes that they were at their place with bayonets fixed, waiting for the next German assault in their trench when artillery fire collapsed their trench on them and they died. And that might be true because there's a bit of a myth to it of what their posture was. But the fact of the matter is they died in service, nobly on the front line. And that sense of service really comes across. But even what's more moving to me is the memorial that's over the trench, and it was put up by American banker George Rand. And again, Monique, correct my French if I'm wrong, but basically it just says to, in memory of the soldiers, the French soldiers who are standing rifle in hand and gave their lives. Is that about right? But the more important part, roughly, the more important part, this is how it works with French. But the more important part is that it's from their American brothers. And then back then it was brothers, and that's okay. But from their American brothers, because this sense of respect and this shared service is something I think people forget. I can only imagine, sir, what you went through in Afghanistan and the horrors of battle and the colleagues that we've lost in conflict. But through it all, I think what sometimes people don't understand, in our country, only 0.5% of people have served in uniform. So they don't always know. They may not have a relative who served. They may not know. But this sense of respect and shared purpose and shared service, I think that's what we touch on And if it comes to it, we would give our lives. But if we survive, we still respect and we value them. So it was really a powerful memory for our family. Also in Belgium, not too far from Mons, is Bastogne, which was at the heart of the Battle of the Bulge in the dead of winter in 1944, when the 101st Airborne was under siege in Bastogne. And the weather came in and the Army Air Forces could not get in to supply them or provide artillery fire. Sorry, we couldn't get in. But the 101st had one doctor, and they had one Belgian nurse they found, but they went to the veterinarian in Bastogne, and they said, "We heard that your daughter was training to be a nurse. Could she help us?" And Augusta Chiwi, who's here depicted in 2011 in Brussels, said, "Yes, I'll help." And if you've read Stephen Ambrose's book, Band of Brothers, or watched the movies, you saw a nurse, a woman of color, who they didn't really, they called her Anna, but they didn't know. She pitched in. She was 23 years old, heart of the battle, under siege. And she pitched in and tended to American and Allied soldiers. And when the battle was done, she went home. And then she went and became a nurse, and she was lost. And they searched for years, and finally the Belgian authorities in 2011 found her at the age of 90 in Brussels. And I had the privilege to represent NATO at the ceremony where we honored her. That's my back with her, Augusta Chiwi. And you know, she didn't speak English, and I don't speak French. And I don't know, though, if you can feel the vibrance of this woman. We completely understood each other. The respect, the energy, the sense of service. She passed in 2015 at 94. But I was so honored to meet her. She was a veteran. The sense of service, the sense of respect, it bridged everything. She didn't wear a uniform. But it was just really powerful. And so knowing the stories of people like her really is part of it too. And so today I can't honor each and every person that we have here. I did include in the images the flags, as Matt mentioned. This is a photo from the Super Bowl from 2022 with all the flags except Space Force, and we have a Space Force flag up in the corner from an ROTC unit in Florida. But I wanted to talk about Space Force for a second, because this is the nature of service. You know, not everyone serves in the way those soldiers in the trench ever done served or sacrificed their own lives for the sake of democracy and freedom. Or Madame Chiwi, who nursed soldiers in the heart of battle with courage. There are different ways we serve, and it's hard to explain sometimes, because in our brains and in the movies, we can understand explosions and guns and the good guys and bad guys. But in our complex modern profession of arms, it's difficult. I bring up Space Force because you may wonder why we have it. But you also may not know, many of you may, GPS was a military invention, satellites to help with precision munitions and navigation. And I was a pilot in the Air Force. I was on flying status for 20 years. I flew big airplanes around the world. When I went to pilot training, women were only allowed to fly tankers, trainers, or transports. And I'd just come home from Oxford, and I loved the mission of seeing the rest of the world. So I flew in Africa, and the Middle East, and South America. And navigating was tough. There wasn't the exact, in the 80s, we didn't have GPS yet, where we had inertial navigation and radios, and it was an interesting time of maturity of technology. But when the technology came, it became commercial as well. So now with GPS, what, your phone, the automatic teller machines, ATMs, the timing signals on the gas pump at the gas station, everything depends on it, the internet, on satellites. And our potential adversaries know this. So guess what? They have anti-satellite weapons. So in space, people in Space Force actually move satellites around. They move it around to avoid space junk. They move them around for targeting. what is that? We have trouble processing it because we don't want anything to explode. We wouldn't hear it if it did, right? But it's important in its service. It's very removed from harm's way. It's very removed from the violence, not like the soldiers in the trench. But that's service. So we thank our guardians for their service as well. It's a different service. You know, our Vietnam vets I wanted to include because they were not welcomed home. And they were drafted in the main, even though many people who served in the past, in spite of the draft, would have volunteered anyway. The draft ended after Vietnam, so that those of us who have served since serve in an all-volunteer force. And this is one of the reasons we've had to open the doors, because we said, oh, how do we tap everyone as a volunteer and broaden our perspective? It's the other side of inclusion and diversity. We need everybody. We need everybody. The airplane doesn't care what you look like. The satellite doesn't care what you look like. We need everybody. And in the middle of the night when people are doing hard things in cold places and they're all in Gore-Tex blobs, we don't know what each other look like anyway. We just need to know, I can count on you. You can count on me. And that's our service. And so from someone who flew a crew airplane around the world, that was just intensified. And I'd been a basketball player too, so the crew was like a team. And this is my approach to my service on the shoulders of Vietnam veterans. But the bulk of my service came around the time of Desert Shield, Desert Storm, and then Afghanistan and Iraq. And this is inadequate. This, what I put up to symbolically represent those conflicts is inadequate, I know. But everyone looks at it differently. When I look at it, from the perspective I had, working in big logistics and in strategy and strategic matters, whether they're cyber or in space or flying, I look at Afghanistan as a landlocked country whose only port is Karachi, Pakistan, and who's surrounded by the highest mountain ranges in the world. Who can even get there to supply them? I will say this. Darius I of Persia in the 5th century BC tried and went through the Khyber Pass. Alexander the Great in the 4th century BC. The British in the mid-1800s. And I have to tell you, the Iowa National Guard in 2012. So I was on the Khyber Pass between Afghanistan and Pakistan at something called the Torkham Gate. And it's the route to get into Pakistan to get to the port of Karachi. And we went to visit troops there, and we got off the plane and there were 15 Afghan teenage young men in Iowa Hawkeyes t-shirts. And I said, well, this is pretty cool. Is this for me? And it was like, no, the Iowa National Guard were there. So I actually had lunch with the Iowa National Guard on the Khyber Pass, because this is the modern profession of arms and the logistical side of it. And that's what I see. Or I see after 9/11. And I was at a base in Oklahoma then, but I know what happened here. And within a month of that, we needed to strike back. So this very region was so much a part of that, because the B-2 bombers from Whiteman Air Force Base went on a 44-hour mission, and you can look this up, Google B-2 44-hour mission, and did a strike in Afghanistan to say, hey, we're not quite ready to do the whole show yet, but we're paying attention. And they flew, thanks to tankers, many of them from McConnell Air Force Base in Kansas, through the Pacific, for tankers staged along the way, because to fly for 44 hours, they can't do that on even the giant tank of gas that's in a B-2. It took over 25 air refuelings, rendezvousing across the Pacific, Guam and Diego Garcia, which is an atoll in the Indian Ocean territory, and has spent an inordinate amount of time on Diego Garcia for a daughter of an Iowa farmer, to be able to then support the launches into Afghanistan. And supply routes go through there as well, but the immediate response really came from here. And it was controlled by the Air Mobility Command and U.S. Transportation Command at Scott Air Force Base, which is 40 miles east of St. Louis. So that kind of counts as Missouri, too, because Scott Air Force Base is so involved in the business community of St. Louis as well. So when I see these conflicts, I see it from that level. Many of you served in different ways at sea or on the ground. But we also learned that the inside and outside the wire concept was pretty blurry of who's in combat and who's not with this new threats that we have. So I thank those veterans from this era that served in close proximity to violence and harm. And we remember the brothers and sisters of ours that we lost. My aide-de-camp was killed in a helicopter crash in Kabul. And she had joined the Air Force to be a language trainer after 9/11. Her family were German. And then she'd moved to the United States. So many people have served since then. And this part of the country has been such a part of the response to that. So thank you for that. So the last image I've got that I haven't talked about is just, these are World War II veterans in the lower left, and I'll inappropriately lump in the Korean War veterans as well, although the Korean War Memorial is extraordinary in Washington as well. But I guess my point is, each of us has a story, each of us has served in a different way that we may not be able to imagine, because, you know, if we get too focused on our own. But what we need is each other. We need all of us. We need all of our service. The young people who came up and recited the Pledge of Allegiance, the Honor Guard, and the colonel and the sergeant major who are here, they're out there right now. We need all of those skill sets, close to harm's way, working in space, all across the spectrum, to ensure our national security for our wonderful democratic republic, a place where we vote, veterans vote too. We may wear uniforms, but we're not all the same. And that's a freedom that Americans can relish. So I'm really honored to be here with you today. I hope this has given you maybe a little insight on my service. And just know, I thank you so much for what you do. Thank you.
Well, thank you, friends, and we express our appreciation to the American Legion Band of Greater Kansas City. Thank you, General Michelle Johnson, for your personal and moving remarks, and for Congressman Cleaver and Mayor Lucas for your service and being with us today. And most especially, friends, thank you to our veterans, our active duty personnel, for your commitment and for sharing with us this day. We encourage you to spend some time at the Museum and Memorial. As was mentioned earlier, we have a new exhibition, Captured, which really is quite remarkable, as well as our permanent galleries, which always are exciting. I'm going to tease you with the news that we're in the midst of a significant gallery upgrade, including the creation of an open storage that we anticipate will be opened around Memorial Day, which will enable you to see thousands of objects that you would otherwise never see that are currently in our closed storage and will move to open storage. A very exciting era coming over the next several years as we take a major upgrade to what already is one of the world's great museums to make it even better. In a few moments, we will have our closing ceremony activities. Those will be the removal of the POW MIA cover by Colonel James Pangalinan and Command Sergeant Major Brian Billings, after which Reverend Carla Rade will offer the benediction and our program then will end. Thank you, friends, for being with us. If you're able, please stand for our closing activities.
The Hebrew prophet Micah said, "What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?" Indeed, we go forth this day to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. And as you go forth, may the Holy One bless you and keep you. And may the face of the Divine One shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Creator of us all walk with you, give you peace, and be forever with you in kindness. Amen.
Thank you and good day.